Hello, welcome to this very special edition of the Pace Report. I'm Brian Pace, reporting live here at the John and Alice Coltrane Home here in Dix Hills, New York. Today, the National Trust for Historic Preservation is about to unveil John and Alice Coltrane's home being honored as a national treasure. As you know, this is about to become a museum here, which is going to open in the next 5 years. And today we're going to have the unveiling. We're going to have members of the press, as well as members of Dix Hills, as well as the Coltrane family, speak and commemorate the legacy of both John and Alice Coltrane and what this house means to the world of jazz. This is the house also where John Coltrane penned his iconic A Love Supreme. So sit back, relax, and enjoy highlights of the National Trust for Historic Preservation's presentation of John and Alice Coltrane's house being honored as a national treasure here at the John and Alice Coltrane Museum here in Dix Hills, New York. It's part of the Pace Report. I have to start, first of all, by thanking you all for coming. I really appreciate it. We all appreciate it. On behalf of the board, on behalf of all the volunteers who have been trying so hard to bring this home to life, and we are going to bring it back to life. And what an extraordinary honor to be part of the National Treasure Universe of the National Trust for Historic Preservation. And I want to thank the National Trust for helping mentor us through these last few years. They have been absolutely awesome. Let's give them a big hand. This is the second phase, because I was with you guys when you introduced to the world with Carlos Santana and Dr. Cornell West that this was getting ready to be the groundbreaking. And today we've moved a little further now. Tell everybody in the world where we are right now as far as the fundraising and what people can do to contribute to this.
Well, the vision has definitely expanded since that wonderful event back in 2013 with Carlos. And the people who are involved have expanded. We have organizationally, we've grown quite a bit. We have a force of somewhere between 25 and 40 volunteers who have been really putting their shoulder into this project. We are also much further in terms of what's taking place inside the house. The house has, the mold has been completely remediated. It is now a completely safe space. It is also cleaned up. There are lights and things to at least make it functional. We can give tours. We can open the home to the public on a limited basis at this point. We've also done some significant work in terms of the landscaping. We're in the process now of repairing the front cast iron, wrought iron fence that's in front of this house, which is a beautiful thing. And we've gone far in terms of bringing the community and engaging them. We've done a lot of events. We're going into our fifth Coltrane Day Music Festival, which is based on the theme of building community through music, which is precisely the message of John and Alice Coltrane. And I also think that we are at a place now where many, many more people around the world know about what we're doing. And I think evidence of the fact of that is the fact that both McCoy Tyner and Derek Trucks, the former Allman Brothers guitar player, are joining the honorary board this afternoon. And it is really wonderful to see this project catch on.
Today is an exciting day for the arts and historic preservation in Huntington's African American history. We all know Huntington is a home to the arts, and we're proud to have the Coltrane Home as a point of interest in our community. Historic preservation is a priority in our town, from our Huntington's historic district to the north, to this very important property right near our southern border that embodies many very special things. The value we place on the arts and the contributions of notable African American residents in Huntington's history. The Huntington Town Board took the lead in saving this nationally recognized historic site in 2004. And as Ron mentioned, it was Supervisor Patron and Councilman Cutherson and Councilwoman Berlin. And it was in response to a worldwide grassroots effort led by Dix Hills resident Steve Fulgoni. The board designated the home as an historic landmark under the town code, saving it from demolition by a developer that wanted to subdivide the property and redevelop it. 2 years later, the town purchased the home and named the 3-acre site the Coltrane Park. Ownership of the home itself was deeded to the newly formed not-for-profit organization, Friends of the Coltrane Home in Dix Hills, which was charged with restoring the home. The home was listed on the National Register of Historic Places, and in 2011 was named by the National Trust as one of the 11 most endangered historic sites in the country. The Friends of the Coltrane Home, who I've mentioned, have been working to restore the home and create a new kind of house museum, one filled with music and dedicated to sharing the legacy of music, spirituality, and goodwill. Earlier this year, the Friends of the Coltrane Home were awarded a $75,000 grant by the African American Cultural Heritage Action Fund, an initiative of the National Trust, to hire a project manager. So really, over the past few years, we're really seeing the property expand. As was mentioned by Ron, every year down in Hexter Park, we celebrate Coltrane Day. And matter of fact, I just, Ron, wore my shirt on Sunday when I was out in historic Hexter Park. And really, as I was a member of the assembly, I got to tour the home several times. And coming back today as supervisor, you could see the transformation and the people that are giving back to the home to really make it embody what the Coltrane stood for. Their spirituality, their culture, their dedication to music, and of course, being very creative. This place will continue to inspire generations of musicians wanting to follow in the Coltrane footsteps. So we know we're gonna continue to see this place transform to greet many generations of younger musicians and students, and know that the Huntington town will always be a huge supporter of the Coltrane Home. I wanna thank all the volunteers that made this day very special. I wanna thank all the people that have been hard work and dedication, whether it was here in the town of Huntington or across the country, to really make this a great piece, a preserved property, a piece of the history and legacy here in the town of Huntington. Enjoy the rest of the program.
Thank you.
Today is very important because the world is closer and closer to seeing the Museum of John Coltrane and Alice Coltrane opening.
Yes, this is a great day because it has national recognition of such a great place that we have right here in the town of Huntington, a place where the Coltranes helped their family grow and also composed some of their most famous pieces right here. So it's a piece of history that we're very proud of right here in the town of Huntington, and it's going to help, you know, mold future generations of students and musicians and really be a great asset and part of the community. So we're very happy here. My own personal experiences is when you walk through these hallways, you walk through the rooms, these are where historic pieces of music have been composed and have been played. And it's full of culture, it's full of spirituality, and it's also full of creativeness. So we're very happy to continue to foster that creativeness and that spirituality right here in the town of Huntington.
What exactly is the town of Huntington getting ready to do as far as bringing people aware of this historic and this beautiful home?
Well, back in 2004, the town purchased the property and the house that we see. Later on, it was transferred over to a not-for-profit, which became the Friends of the Coltranes. And now the town of Huntington also maintains some of the property here. What we're going to continue to do is make sure people are aware that this exists. We're going to also make sure that people continue to donate to renovate the area so it becomes an area where people can come, they can appreciate, they can learn, and of course be a center of education too.
Tell me the importance of why this house is really kind of the nail in the coffin to commemorate John Coltrane.
Yes, this is the place Coltrane composed of Supreme. He stepped out from here to the Japan just 1 year before he passed away, 1966. He performed a Peace on Earth throughout Japan. We so much appreciate Coltrane music because he brought us the peace on earth for playing the victim of the Nagasaki and the Hiroshima. He played there also, yeah. And also he died here, but actually the Huntington Hospital. But just day before he passed away, he planned to make a recording session in the basement studio here with Ben Reilly. But when Ben Reilly came here, Alice Coltrane said, John went to the hospital. He never returned. If he lives one day longer, they made a recording here in the basement. But who knows? Back in 2004, Steve Fulgari and I went into the inside of the Coltrane Home. At that time, there was lots of pollution, air pollution, so we put the mask, and it was a very dangerous situation. Just a week before this was demolished, but Steve Fulgoni went to the town hall to stop it, to sell to the developer. I'm a big fan of John Coltrane, and I have a Coltrane house in Osaka, Japan. All my Coltrane collection memorabilia storage in my house in Osaka, Japan. Many people wanted to come to see, like Herbie Hancock, Carlos Santana, Marcus Miller, Cassandra Wilson, John Lovato, and Michael Bragg, all these, you know, great cats who love John Coltrane came to my house for dinner and see my collection. I have more than 2,000 memorabilia of John Coltrane.
Right up to that.
And wrote a full book, four books about subject about John Coltrane. And two are written in English, two are written in Japanese. One book, my photo album, is available for sale today to donate the money to the home. Thank you.
Tom, why is this very important for music fans as well as the legacy of John Coltrane?
Wow, well, big picture, jazz is our American-born art form. It's our soundtrack. So anytime we could celebrate our great history, it's a victory for us in the jazz community. But Coltrane was so important in the history and the lineage of jazz, and Alice and the family. This is just a real special day that we could promote what he did and great gifts that he gave to us.
His spaces provide direct connection to some of their most seminal works and significant personal milestones. The living room, with its herringbone patterned wood paneling and brick fireplace, served as the inspiration for John's 1965 composition, Living Space. Alice's meditation room, with its circular window and shag carpeting, was where her experience as a spiritual leader began. The basement studio is where she recorded her 1968 monastic trio and several of her other albums. And last but certainly not least, the composition room / guest bedroom is where John composed The Love Supreme, described as his musical autobiography, where he emerged fully formed, categorically cementing his connection to this home and the Coltrane's livelihood and legacy. We have many people to thank for being able to behold this physical manifestation of John and Alice's lives and careers. As you all likely know, in 2005, at the urging of local resident Steve Fulgoni and other supporters, along with extraordinary support from musicians and music lovers from around the world, such as Herbie Hancock, John McLaughlin, and Michael Brecker, the town of Huntington bought the property from a developer who intended to demolish the house. The house was then purchased by the Friends of the Coltrane Home in Dix Hills, the very group that remains the proud and able stewards of this home and such passionate champions of its past and its future. The National Trust is proud to be part of the effort to raise awareness of the importance of this place and the imperative to preserve it. In 2011, we named the home to our list of America's 11 most endangered historic places. And since that time, we have been working with the Friends of the Coltrane Home in Dix Hills on preservation planning to stabilize the home and strategizing how to implement the vision for its future reuse. Which leads me to why I am standing here today. I am delighted to officially announce that the John and Alice Coltrane Home has been designated a national treasure. National treasures are the Trust Signature Initiative, where we partner with communities to save nationally significant historic places. And we have a revolving portfolio of 90 special places across the country. The National Trust is working to save other national treasures that tell a truer, more authentic, more inclusive American story. Places like the Durham, North Carolina home of activist Pauli Murray, a fierce and effective advocate for the rights of African Americans and women. A person who, according to Justice Thurgood Marshall, who once said that her legal research was the Bible of civil rights law. Or like special places like Villa Loaro, the home of the legendary Madam C.J. Walker in Irvington, New York, America's first self-made female millionaire. And as we just announced last June, the childhood home of Nina Simone, legendary civil rights icon and revolutionary musician and singer. Yeah. The John and Alice Coltrane Home stands at the center of our work to identify and preserve the places that tell the often overlooked stories of African Americans and their many contributions to our cultural fabric. It brings life to the story of a revolution in music and teaches us about the achievements and contributions of African American men and women. Seeing and experiencing firsthand this place and other landmarks that served as incubators of jazz remind a younger generation and all Americans about the power of creativity and art in changing the rhythm of our nation. Jazz is uniquely American, a creative art form birthed by Black musicians and embedded throughout the world of music. The Coltrane Home is the physical manifestation of jazz history, and it stands as a historic monument to tell this story. While other historic houses from John Coltrane's life still exist, they are not accessible to the public. The Dix Hill Home thus presents a unique opportunity to interpret the lives and legacies of this extraordinary couple. Together, the National Trust and our partners are committed to creating a new kind of historic site at the John and Alice Coltrane Home, one that will inspire visitors to embrace the creativity, love of music, social justice, and goodwill embodied in the lives of both artists. We look forward to providing our expertise in historic preservation to help guide the continued restoration effort for this site. And we are excited to work with you on how we bring alive the magic and meaning of this home for a broader audience. As a cultural center where the music and humanitarian and creative spirit of both John and Alice Coltrane is written on these very walls. Thank you for joining us on this exciting journey. Thank you, Town of Huntington, for celebrating and honoring this remarkable history. And we thank you all for coming out today. Congratulations on your designation as a national treasure.
Brent, this has been a very important day for the world of music. Mm-hmm. And your organization has done some very important things to make sure that the John and Alice Coltrane Home is now in existence. Tell us where we are right now and where we have to go further.
So I work for an organization called the National Trust for Historic Preservation, and we made a special announcement today that John and Alice Coltrane's home has been designated one of our newest national treasures. Yeah, this means that we partner with communities, including the board, the John and Alice Coltrane Home Board, Town of Huntington and other partners, to develop a master plan for the reuse and interpretation of the space. And our goal is to support the board in realizing their vision for the house, and we anticipate it to be open to the public in about 3 years.
What do you think the music world is going to, how the music world is going to appreciate this home once it opens?
They're going to celebrate it just like we are. You know, John composed The Love Supreme in the guest bedroom on the second floor. Alice recorded 5 albums in the basement studio. There's no other place in the entire world that could be used to interpret their physical legacy. And not only will the preservation community, hopefully all Americans, but musicians world around will champion and support this worthy and important project.
Thank you all so much for coming. It's a wonderful thing to stand in front of the home and to know that things are happening and that this wonderful national recognition that we're so grateful for from the National Historic Trust is happening today. This is a good day for a project that has required a lot of you to be very patient, and we are very grateful for that patience, and we are going to live up to your belief in us. There's been a lot of talking today, and I actually don't want to talk that much, but I would encourage everybody to go into the home and take a moment. It's going to be a contemplative, inspirational place. Even in the state that it's in now, it's a wonderful thing to go inside and to feel the pretty spectacular things that happened in this rather modest home. I'd also like to just take one moment to say that one of our most important missions for Friends of the Coltrane Home is the elevation and engagement of the Alice Coltrane musical legacy. And I think that we could all agree that we're living in a time that demands recognition for our prominent women artists, if for no other reason than to inspire us. So I would also encourage you all to think about Alice's amazing things that she did in this home. She raised a young family, first as a young wife and then as a young widow. During that same time that she was doing that, she made amazing music. She made impulse recordings that not only stand the test of time, but that were groundbreaking then and are groundbreaking now. So I encourage you all to listen to those recordings also. And you're lucky enough that the person who's going to follow that I'm going to introduce is Michelle Coltrane. She's a wonderful testament to her parents' spirit, and she follows in her beloved mother's footsteps. She's a wonderful singer, a very creative force, an arranger and a composer, and she speaks, I think, better than almost anyone on the merits of the home. So thank you so much for being here today.
I just had tipped away for a minute to go absorb some of the energy in the home. I had felt like, kind of like a spirit, you know, reflecting on my young self as a child, and to stand in the home as an adult and go through each room with memories flooding back as anyone would going into a, you know, space that they once had lived in. See, if I had 3 things I wanted to focus on to share for my, that's my Michelle memory. They called me Mickey when I was a little girl. But I think that the most powerful thing I wanted to feel and be reminded of was our family was whole. This was the place where both parents were alive. All of the 4 children were living. And we had Christmas together, and I remember standing in the room and my mother laughing because we were tearing through all the gifts because we didn't look at the names. And I remember our parents chuckling about that because, you know, we were, you know, just some little rascals at that time. But I wanted to say thank you to everyone. I know a lot of people have been mentioned in thanks, and I certainly want to reach out to the volunteers and the community. It's nice to be able to serve a cause that you love, and this is certainly a great one. I appreciate that so much on behalf of the entire family. I also, you're welcome. I wanted to say everybody's name also. John Sr., Alice, John Coltrane Jr., Ravi Coltrane, Oran Coltrane, and me, Michelle Coltrane. We thank you very, very much. And I want to encourage everyone to also remember that we all contribute what we have with our particular talents and whatever way of people saying they put the flowers in to people that share their knowledge of architecture. You know, we all can be a part of something great when we do that. And I'm seeing this is an example of that. And thank you so much for helping preserve memories that were personal to me and honoring the life and legacy of John and Alice Coltrane. Thank you, and Om Shanti. Peace.
Michelle, this is another beautiful day for the legacy of your father and your family. And looking at where we are right now, are you happy with the progress where we're going?
I couldn't. I'm amazed. I can't believe that it's really, really happening.
You standing back here because you spent a little bit of your childhood here. What are some of your fondest memories here?
Well, there's a lot. I remember getting a collie. The dog's name was Rex. There's pictures of it. The dog, I've seen some of those. The Christmas that we had, it was kind of brief here. And my mother, unfortunately, became a widow at a pretty young age, 29 years old, and she had four young children, which I can't even imagine. But God's plan. And but the beautiful side of it is that from all of that is, you know, where we are today is because of the sacrifice and the forward thinking. My mother's music was basically few knew of it, and it's was actually these music she recorded in the 90s. It was being bootlegged, and it kind of prompted a release of the material in the correct manner. And it seems to be as healing as John Coltrane's music was. So now there's young people walking around saying they're Alice Coltrane fans, and they're kind of newly exposed to it. So all of that, reflecting upon my memories here, I don't, even the things that were not so great that were, you know, like it was short and I wished it was longer and we'd had more time like anyone would with their family and their loved ones, it's kind of turned into something we couldn't even have imagined.
Pat, you played with the legendary John Coltrane. Give us some of your reflections on John as a musician.
John Coltrane was an amazing musician. I used to love to play with him because he would do things sometimes. Say, what the hell did you do there? What did you say? Well, I did this and this and this and this. So I used to get a lot of tips from John.
prince, I love the prince, I love the free, 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 I love the free.
Thanks for coming, everyone. I've had a great time getting to know Ron Stein, who just spoke, and I have to tell you a story about Daryl, who I've just met the first time, but I heard this music playing on my Sirius radio, and I called a friend and asked, hey, have you ever heard of this guy? This guy, Trucks, the guitar player, and he's like, oh yeah, he's badass, you know? And I can't believe that things just connect like that. So it's a pleasure to meet you, and I'm honored to have you here. I really enjoyed seeing the home today. When the car pulled up, I was anxious to jump out of the car, and as I got towards the garage, that first step, I had to stop, and I wanted it to just go in slow motion and let everything just absorb, you know. It was a real, it was very powerful to, because I was seeing in my mind, remembering the size that I was the last time that I walked through the home. And thank you so much for it's definitely something that community has to do. Even in my mind, if I had wanted to do something like this, in my own ways, of course, I do things to honor the legacy of both my parents. And that's what we're also, you know, encouraging young people to do in our family, as well as for their own families. Everybody has a story to tell. Everybody's life is important. Every soul has significance. And I'm just very appreciative that people could come together on something like this. I think the music of both of my parents speaks very to the essence of universality, is that a word? And cality. And it seems to have a healing quality. I can't tell you how many stories, when you start hearing the same story over and over, you kind of believe it, you know. When I was a young girl, people would grab my arm and say, I listened to A Love Supreme, and I quit doing this, or I started doing that, or I play it every day. It's kind of like became like kind of a ritual for people. And I hear the same thing about Alice's music. So just thank you all very much. And I thought we were gonna do a listening thing later, so I hope everyone stays. And if there's any questions anybody has, I'm happy to answer those.
One of the amazing things, and one of the reasons why the Coltrane project is so remarkable, has been the manner in which John Coltrane, perhaps more than any other jazz musician, impacted the rock world, the jam band world, from the Grateful Dead to the Allman Brothers to the Doors, U2, today Kendrick Lamar and Common and Flying Lotus. So many bands have been influenced, so many people, by the music of Coltrane, the passion of Coltrane, the spirituality of Coltrane. And I have to say that no one embodies that more than you, Derek. It is a really special honor. So the honorary board currently is chaired by Carlos Santana. It has on it Chick Corea, Randy Brecker, Jimmy Heath, Marcus Miller, and I'm sure there are a host of other names I'm forgetting at the moment. We could talk about that later. But let me read to you and present you with this plaque. Derek Trux stands as a shining example of the way John Coltrane's enduring legacy transcends all boundaries of genre and generation. While the band he leads with his wife Susan Tedeschi is best known for its potent blend of blues, rock, and soul, improvisation has always been at the very heart of Derek's creative essence. As a teenager, he delved deeply into the rich history and catalog of jazz, which soon became an integral part of his musical approach, his playing often sounding more akin to a horn than a guitar. He has long cited Coltrane as a crucial formative influence and inspiration, and like Train, he consistently challenges himself and his collaborators to achieve the highest level of spontaneous musical communication and expression. Accordingly, the John and Alice Coltrane Home is very pleased to welcome Derek Trux to our honorary board.
When I heard about this project, it reminded me of the Big House Museum down in Macon, Georgia, where the Allman Brothers started, and the amount of people that come from all over the world on the pilgrimages to this place, just seeing their face when they walk in, and there's this real tangible connection with this music they love. And when I heard about the John and Alice House, that's the first thing that I thought of, is how important it's gonna be for people. I remember being on the road early on in a van with a trailer, and we made a trip to Hamlet, North Carolina to go look for his birth home. And there wasn't much to be found, but it was still important to go search. when this place opens, I think it's going to be, it's especially now, like you were saying, the day and age we're in, things that are true and pure, are we got to protect them. And so I think this is going to be a great conduit for that. You know, the place where A Love Supreme was conceived, and probably some children, and plenty of records. These are things that, that last and are important. The children that I've met are it's important they're here too. So I'm honored to be a part of this. And, anything we can do to help, we're gonna do. And I can't wait till it's fully up and running. So thank you.
Congratulations on this monumental day. Moving forward, tell the viewers what John Coltrane means to you, and also what you're going to bring to this house.
You know, he's one of those artists, it's beyond music, you know, it becomes a part of your life. I mean, there's at least once or twice a night when we're playing and you're in the middle of something that you're thinking about that sound, you're thinking about that spirit, and you're trying to dig down, you know. And I think that's always with you. There's a handful of influences that you have, people that inspire you that never go away. And then, you know, finding out about the house and the work that they're trying to do to preserve it, it becomes an important thing. It's something you want to help facilitate, help get back to, whether it's setting up booths at the show so people can be turned on to it, or just kind of sending people that way. But I'm excited to see how it turns out. I know it's going to be an important place. So,
Derek, you are so very important to the rock blues element of the American roots sector. you bringing this to the jazz element and all of that comes out with improvisation, how is it that you're going to reach to the next generation to understand not only just the music that you're playing and you're communicating, yeah, but also jazz music?
I think you do it by the way you play and the way you present it. And you know, I see a lot of young faces in our audience that that show up at shows with John Coltrane shirts on, and they know the history and they know the story and they know where it comes from, and it's from the music we play and the music that you point to. And I remember early on a guy named Dick Waterman, and he managed Sun House and some of the early Delta blues musicians, and they in the 60s when there was this folk revival, and we did a Sun House tune on one of our first records, and Dick Waterman came out, and he came out to a little club we were playing, but he wanted me to know. He said, when you record these tunes, I'm able to give a check to the family. It might be small, but remember that as you get bigger. It's important to keep these legacies in mind. It's important to keep this music in mind. And when the audience grows, you don't want to leave that. You want to always point where it came from. Like, know where it came from, and don't pretend otherwise. And that's something that always stuck with me. It's you know, so we try to do that. When we play John Coltrane's music, or we play any artist that you revere, you make sure that people know, this is where this came from. This is what this is. Go buy that record. So that's what you do. You do what you can.
John Coltrane and McCoy Tyner, the names are inseparable. McCoy was so integral to John finding his own voice, emboldening John to pursue his cosmic explorations. McCoy is a member of John's best-known, best-loved ensemble, built on a foundation that included, let's not forget, Elvin Jones, Jimmy Garrison, and before him, Reggie Workman. Within that context, McCoy Tyner helped create the very harmonic language on which John soared, harmonic language, and expanded and transformed the music dialogue, the musical dialogue forever. Music dialogue has not been the same since McCoy touched those keys. As a leader, he personified everything that John stood for musically and spiritually. And McCoy, despite his influence and connection with John, we know was a massive force in his own right. A great leader, a great band leader, an incredible composer, and a musician change maker like John was on sax. Simply put, and as countless musicians attest in their playing and words, McCoy Tyner forever changed the way the piano was played. The piano has never sounded the same. For those reasons, among many others, the John and Alice Coltrane Home is honored to welcome McCoy Tyner to our honorary board.
Like to say is that we thank everybody for coming. Tyner family, we thank you. This has been a part of my life, my whole life. As you know, this is something that what you guys are doing here is something that's going to transcend and continue for generations to come. Hopefully, even I have a son, my son, his generation will know about this wonderful quartet, about, you know, Coltrane, about everyone that was involved in that time period. This is really a phenomenal thing that you're doing and that Ron is doing, and I'm very, very happy and proud that we are a part of this and that we were able to come today and participate in this phenomenal event. Thank you.
Let's give a big hand to Aisha, yeah, Dean, and McCoy Tyner.
That'll do it again for another edition of the Pace Report. I'm Brian Pace, reporting live here at the John and Alice Coltrane Home here in Dix Hills, New York. I'd like to personally thank the National Trust for Historic Preservation for putting this together, as well as I'd like to personally thank the staff and management at the John and Alice Coltrane Home. For more information and to contribute and donate, please visit them online at www.thecoltranehome.org. As always, please visit my website, www.thepacereport.com, for my weekly column, as well as my past segments. Until next time, remember, if it's in the groove, it'll make you move. Till next time, peace.